accept challenges, reject norms, push boundaries. This is Barrow Neurosurgery Basecamp. Your front seat to the teaching rounds of Michael Lawton and Juan Uribe. Join Barrow residents and renowned guests as they seek to understand the most complex, difficult, intricate cases. This is inside access you'll find nowhere else. A journey you'll never forget. Come with us as we climb the trail from base camp to the very pinnacle of neurosurgical excellence.
This episode today is called Punched. There's a quote by Mike Tyson, and it goes, "Everybody has a plan till they get punched in the mouth." Now, I am by no means a boxer, but I like this quote because it just speaks to the unexpected. Whether it's stepping into the ring or stepping into the operating room, you just have to be flexible and you have to go with whatever hits you. This is a posterior cerebral artery aneurysm. I thought I could clip this. The aneurysm ruptured on me, the neck tore. I had to then excise the aneurysm and do a clip reconstruction. That didn't work, so then I had to go to a bypass, an excision, and a reanastomosis. That failed, and then I had to excise the part that I had stitched together and then revise it all together. So it's about staying flexible, coming in with discrete plans, escalating your way up that list of contingency plans, and finally getting to your fix. So with that, we just pulled a couple of interesting cases from the last few weeks just to kind of talk about, and we'll just have some fun with these. This is a case that we'll start with. This is a 40-year-old woman who presented with a sudden severe headache and had a CT scan which showed this, CT, CTA. And Gabby, why don't you lead us off here?
So I see on the right side what looks like a P2 aneurysm. And looks like potentially, it's hard to see without scrolling, maybe a fetal PCA on that side.
Good. And so she presented with a sudden severe headache. It was actually about 10 days before. And she gave a pretty convincing story for that. Anything you want to order or think about?
Obviously looks like I don't see any subarachnoid hemorrhage on this CT. You can get an LP just to ensure that you have subarachnoid hemorrhage or not.
Okay, so her LP was totally negative. What do you think of when you see this? Anything about that signal that looks a little funny to you? What goes through my mind is when you have something that should be round and you see this kind of picture like that, what I'm thinking is that that's the lumen and this is could very well be thrombus. So this could be a thrombotic aneurysm. It's just this, this abnormal edge there raises that concern. So what would you do?
So I think this is large enough to warrant treatment. She's only 40 years old. So we have it's like proven no subarachnoid hemorrhage, so you don't have to put her on subarachnoid hemorrhage protocol or Triple H therapy. How we get an angiogram first to get a better look at the aneurysm. It's like not a fetal PCA, but coming off of the P1, P2 segment, it's a large, irregularly shaped fusiform aneurysm coming off of that segment.
Which segment did you say?
I think P1, P2.
All right, what's the dividing line between P1 and P2?
The PCOM takeoff.
Hi, I'm Gabriella Paisan. I'm one of the PGY4 neurosurgery residents at the Barrow Neurological Institute. I first thought about becoming a neurosurgeon actually when I was in college. I had a ruptured cavernous malformation when I was in college and had an awake craniotomy to remove it. That experience really inspired me to pursue neurosurgery in medical school. Having had that experience myself, knew that I wanted to be involved in the care of those patients and always found it fascinating, and it's an exciting field to be a part of. I think that experience has helped me understand the patient experience a little bit better, and only helps me in becoming a neurosurgeon and understanding all facets of their care. Neurosurgery is a great field to be a part of. It's always changing. There's always new technology, and the surgeries themselves are technically sophisticated, and there's always something new to learn, and we're always pushing boundaries in this field, which is something exciting to be a part of. Right now I'm on a complex spine rotation with one of our deformity spine surgeons, and I'm loving putting pedicle screws in every day and seeing those patients in clinic and how their lives have changed and improved from some of our surgeries, and it's been exciting to be a part of that process. Part of the reason why I wanted to be at Barrow is because here you can become the best surgeon you could possibly be, and my goal is to be as technically excellent as I can be out of training and understand how to take care of these patients as best that I can. I know that through my training here, that will all be possible. We have great work-life balance here at Barrow as residents. We have a great relationship with the attendings, and actually a lot of our events throughout the year are focused on, you know, fostering those relationships. We have the Hike from Hell, which is every Labor Day weekend. It's a long, arduous hike through a slot canyon in northern Arizona. And at the end of it, we all have a party. And, you know, it really, in some ways, it's emblematic of neurosurgery residency. You go through a lot together. It's a lot of hard work, late nights, and being tired, but you have each other for support, and you lean on each other during those times.
Okay, and what's the divide line between P2 and P3?
With the lateral border, the pedoncle goes around the cruciate vertebra.
If you look at PCOM, PCOM is going to be right about here, and the back of the tectum is here. So from PCOM to the back of the tectum is the P2 segment, and what you're talking about, the cruciate of the pedoncle right here, that's what divides A from P. So P, this is a P2P segment aneurysm. 3 is back here and 1 is up here. So to be really specific, it's a P2P.
Given the fact this is more fusiform, even SCIT approach would make sense.
So a skit, you'd want to go kind of from the side back here. How would you manage this?
I think microsurgery is the best option, but skit can be an option too, but subtemporal.
Subtemporal, okay. Yeah, subtemporal is probably your best, most direct way. Going in, what any other things you'd want in your back pocket on this? Like, are you thinking you're going to clip this?
Well, it's fusiform aneurysm, so you may need to trap the aneurysm, so maybe bypass.
All right, and so if you're thinking bypass, what would you do to prepare for that?
Either STA or...
So harvesting the STA is a good thought, because if you get into trouble and you need a bypass, you can have that in your back pocket. So Dr. Spetzler, what would be your kind of initial out of the gate plan for this one?
This would be sort of nice to see an MRI scan on, just to see whether there is thrombosis or whether this is just the abnormal shape of the dissecting aneurysm that's right next to the tentorium. And I think Those that occur right there are often a result of the irritation of the artery by the edge of the tentorium. So I think this is much more likely to be a dissecting aneurysm. It looks like it may have a fairly narrow neck. In fact, I don't really see the neck very well defined. But I think the way you laid it out, it's really right at the border of supracerebellar infratentorial and going subtemporal. The advantage of supratentorial is that you don't have to retract any brain to get there. The disadvantage is you're not going to have proximal control to start off with, whereas if you come from the subtemporal route, you do have that. So, I mean, subtemporal, OZ, that's sort of a combination. You can come all the way up to where the third segment can starts, although it's a long reach. So I like the way it was outlined. STA ready for a bypass. We have done in the past bypass from the occipital artery to the distal PCA, but when we really reviewed our results, they were not particularly good. The bypass is a very small vessel, and it's right at the cortical edge. Some of them work nice, but not adequate. So I think the way this is outlined, I like that.
So I'm going to just show the interop video here. This is the temporal lobe, obviously. And this is now coming under the temporal lobe, which is here. Here's your tentorium up here. And this is our aneurysm here. You see how fragile this thing was. So just coming on this thing and getting our first looks, this thing started to bleed out. That's just an indication of just how fragile that was. So, Gabby, let's go back to you. What would you do at this stage of the game?
Put a temporary clip proximally for better control and to make the interview softer.
We got our proximal control coming in. That was, as Dr. Spetzler mentioned, the advantage of the subtemporal. Here's the tentorium here. We had all this in front of us, and we could follow our route to the aneurysm here. And when this thing ruptured, it was actually pretty easy to control. You put your temporary clip on, and then what?
Already exposed the dome and tried to expose the neck. At that point, your clip on.
You mean your permanent clip?
Yeah.
Yeah, so to put a permanent clip on, what do you have to find first?
Make sure that you find your distal PCA.
Yeah, so in your mind's eye, as you're building this picture, we've got the inflow, but we have no idea where the outflow is. So in order to get any permanent clips on, you've got to figure out where exactly is that outflow artery on the other side. And the other question is what?
Are there any perforators?
Or are there two? Is this a branch point? So is there a second one and a two that we need to find for our outflow? As soon as you get things controlled, there's our rupture. Now we've got to look for that distal anatomy, because otherwise we just don't know where we're going. So the whole point of driving ourselves back here is to find that distal artery, and there it is. So I saw it coming out here. I've got a clip on it now. And here's a little rent in the aneurysm, you can see. And this is a second artery. So there is the second one. So this actually was, in fact, two. Now that I've got the clips on both, it's controlled. But now, let's take a look. What are we seeing right here? So the fourth nerve is infratentorially, but it's climbing over to the tent. So that's a landmark for us. Our tent is here, obviously. So at this point, it's become clear to me that I can't, this is dolichoectatic. That, by the way, is thrombus intraluminally. And this is not something that is easily going to be clipped. It's not a simple neck. So does anyone know what I'm trying to do here? This is what Dr. Spetzler used to call the napkin ring. And I never understood that because I didn't know what a napkin ring was or how it related to this. But as I've thought about napkin rings, the idea is you take, I think this is how I understand it. A napkin gets stuffed into a ring and you're cutting across the part that's going into the ring so that you're just left with that little round circle. And then once you've reduced the complexity of that aneurysm to just that little circle, then you can clip it and close it off. Did I get that right?
Yeah. Okay. It took you a long time. Most residents were their second year, but
always been slow. All right, so there's the napkin ring, and I'm trying to do the Spetzler napkin ring, and it was clear to me that it wouldn't work. When we look at this, our inflow is here. This is base of the aneurysm, and there's this tear. It's really right at this junction of these two arteries here. So there's really no way that the napkin ring is going to work. All right, so now what?
Potentially prepare for a bypass if you're out of clipping options.
So I was sloppy on this case. I didn't want to take the time to harvest the STA. So I went straight to an excision and a reanastomosis. And I'm going to make a mistake here, because the problem with excision reanastomosis is you're cutting out a segment, and it's very difficult sometimes when you excise to then have enough slack to bring the ends together. So what do you do when you're not sure the ends are going to come back together? You cheat and you leave bad tissue in place. So if you look in here, this is really unhealthy tissue actually on both sides of the divide. And then I did another thing here that didn't turn out to be so good, and that was to I sewed the back wall intraluminally, and it was really hard to get good bites through such a small opening. So what you're going to see here is that we've completed this. We do our IC green, and this is something you never want to see, and that's that there's no flow in the bypass that you just spent all that time working on. At this stage of the game, I knew that the ends would come together, and you don't have to get too much additional artery out to get back to some good normal tissue. So I just bit the bullet, and I'm going back on with my temporary clips. I'm going to excise a little bit more on each end until I'm truly at healthy tissue. So that piece comes out. And since it was only like 2 millimeters of tissue, I knew that things would come back together again.
And I'm going to do what I should have done initially, which was to sew in the traditional way. So this is basically just a round the horn 360 end to end. Instead of sewing inside the lumen, I just sewed around the horn and I twisted the arteries as I went. And you can see how it was a much easier way to get good bites and good views of the tissue there. Standard technique, but you can see once that back wall is in, you rotate it the other way, sew the front wall, and then now the second go was a success. There's our confirmation, good flow, and we've got the PCA reconstructed. Now what's wrong with this solution to the problem? There's a second branch that we haven't dealt with. So, you know, that's one of the problems with excision reanastomosis. It really is just a way to deal with a simple fusiform, one in, one out aneurysm. So I did sacrifice the other branch, but I chose the bigger of the two, and I chose the one that I thought was going back to visual cortex, not the one going up the parieto-occipital sulcus. You know, that was a calculated gamble. You can see, here's our distal flow out that artery, and it's nicely repaired. I just saw this woman in clinic maybe 2 weeks ago, and she did beautifully. Her vision was totally normal.
How close was the SCA at that point?
Great question. So here's the SCA, which is infratentorial, and this is the PCA supratentorial. These two can pull together, and you can do a PCA-SCA bypass. They've only done it in this space up here, where you're a little bit more in front. I think it's a little harder in the back. The SCA branches into the cranial and the caudal trunks, and it gets really small, so it would have been hard there, but that was in the back of my mind.
So I'm sort of surprised, since you're such a proponent of getting bypass ready.
Yeah.
We all fall into that trap. We think we have the solution. In retrospect, what you have.
Well, you know, I am, how did you put it? Bypass ready, bypass prone. It's true, I do like to do them, but I like to get to the point where I'm convinced in my mind that it's absolutely necessary. Like, I like to go down that series of escalating steps, and I don't like to do it knowing that it's not necessary, because first of all, it's tons more work, and if it doesn't work, then it's really embarrassing if a simpler solution would have worked.
And no, I agree. And the brain really tolerates. I mean, if you really had to go back and get the STA, if you weren't able to get it, you could still have done that. Because when the brain is only margin-wise ischemia from that one vessel under anesthesia, burst suppression, a little bit of cooling, they tolerate that. But I really don't think the risk of ischemic injury to repair this is high. Yeah, very nice, very nice.
All right, any other commentary, questions?
If you had wanted to save the other branch, what would have been the preferred strategy?
If the other branch had some length to it, you could have reimplanted it on either either end of that reconstruct. So it could have been a end-to-end plus a reimplant. You could have done, as Dr. Spetzler said, a reimplant down to the SCA. That could have been a good additional donor. So you could get clever with this, but it's a lot of work.
One other point, though, which is a very good one, because I wasn't sure whether I wouldn't have picked SCA. I mean, SCA ice going from the top, and that would have been tough, because your options for doing the bypass are pretty much nil. So that was the right approach.
Yeah, that's true. I don't know that I've done an SCA infratentorial bypass in that space.